In this video, we will be setting up our line trace so that way we can simulate firing a simple projectile weapon. We'll also use debugging to verify it's working, but we're not actually going to hook up anything to the event to actually validate that we're hitting anything. Let's go ahead and get started. So, since we're going to be using a line trace to simulate firing, we might want a way to actually fire the line trace. What we need to do is go back into our input settings, and we're going to set up a way for the left button to be our action. So, it's just like we did for our movement. We'll go back to project settings. We'll go into the input itself, and we're going to go ahead and set up a button for firing. Now, when I discuss the difference between action and access mapping, this would be a case where we're going to use the action mapping. This will be what happens when we push the button and an action occurs. We'll go ahead and do new action mapping. Let's just do this one, action button one. Even though we're going to assign this to the left mouse button right now, we may want it to be the primary action button on the gamepad. Maybe we want to add the space bar as well. We'll just simply call this action button one, which will be our primary action button. And this is all we need to do. Now we have an event called action button one, and it's tied to the left mouse button. Let's go ahead and close this down and set up our event. So, like everything else, there are a few different ways of doing this. We could have our controller, which is currently controlling our character, fire off the line trace and do something. Or we could have the player handle everything. For this example, what we're going to do is we're going to take the input through the controller, because that's where all of our input comes from. But then we're going to pass it along to our controlled pawn and let our controlled pawn handle it. Maybe the controlled pawn has extra fire modes. Maybe our character has more than one place it's going to fire from. Maybe it needs to do a line trace from three different spots instead of one. We don't really know. We're going to let the character itself handle what happens when you push the button. So we're going to end up using blueprint interfaces, and we're going to pass that information along. So the first thing we need to do is we need to hook up our left mouse button event in our player controller. Let's go ahead and close down what we have open and open up our player controller. Now, we have all of this that we've made already. Let's go ahead and tidy this up a little bit, create a comment so that way it's not as disorganized, and then move it to the side. That way we don't have an issue with it. Now, all I'm doing is moving things around a little bit to get lined up. We're going to select everything, hit C, and we're going to do our player controls. Now we have a section called player controls that we can just simply ignore because we're done with that section. Now, let's go ahead and do our input. Now we called it action button one. We have action event, action button one. Now when we add this in, rather than our access input events having an access value, this simply has an indicator for the key, a pressed, and a released. For the most part, we're not going to worry about the key because we don't really care if it's altered or if it's going to, for example, be the space as opposed to the fire button. We're just going to want to know if it's pressed or not pressed. This one's pretty simple. What we need to do is simply call an event that's going to tell the controlled pawn that we went ahead and did something. So if we go to our character and we set up a new event, let's say called handle action button one. So we type in action button one, action events. We're going to have, well, it's the same thing. It's the input action. We don't actually have anything specific where we can connect from the controller to the character. Now we can take this. We could get the controlled pawn. And then we could, let's say we were in our character, we made a custom event, and we called it action button one. And then we went over here, and then we went back to here, and then we'd have to take our control pawn and cast it to our first person shooter character. And then as a first person shooter character, we would do action button one, and then we would end up calling it. But let's say, for example, our pawn wasn't a first-person shooter character. Let's say it was a third-person shooter character, or we had separate character subclasses. It might end up causing an issue. What we can do is use blueprint interfaces instead. Blueprint interface is basically an interface between two different things, and it's a way of guaranteeing an event will be on something, but it doesn't have to be implemented. And if it's not implemented, then it's simply going to do nothing, and you're not really going to have a failure state. It's also useful because you don't need to cast to a target in order to use an interface. So let's see this in action. We're going to make a new interface, blueprint interface on our character. So we do blueprints, blueprint interface, and let's make it simple, FPS character BPI for blueprint interface. When we open it up, it's pretty simple. It just has function names. We're going to make this very, very simple. Our event is called action button 1. So let's handle action button 1. That's it. That's all our event's going to be called. When we go back to our character, if we did handle action button 1, you're going to see handle action button 1, and we can add it. But this is not what we want either. This is how you call handle action button 1. We want to handle handling action button 1. Now our issue here is, even though we've created an interface, we haven't told our character to use the interface. This is really simple. We go to our class settings, go to our implemented interfaces, and add the interface we just created, FPS character blueprint interface. Now here's the key. Even though we've added it, we still don't have it in here properly. You need to compile so that way your character knows it's using the interface. It's going to add in this as an actionable event. And now when we do handle action button 1, we have the add event. If you notice, it looks like our normal event, except we have this little icon on the top that basically is it's a messaging interface is what this indicates. And if you notice, this comes from the FPS character blueprint interface. Well, let's go ahead and see this in action just to test it. Let's print string. Debugging while you are working with really simple things like printing is really handy to make sure stuff works before you spend 10 hours implementing something and then finding it simply didn't work from the start. So at this point in time, if we call this, it should print the string hello. Let's go back to our controller and let's tell it to do that. So this one's pretty simple. Like I said before, we could do the casting and we can do all those other funky things, or now that we have a controlled pawn, we can always do the handle action button 1 message. Now you'll notice this basically will call handle action button 1 using the interface FPS character BPI. If we hook this up to the pressed event, let's go ahead and run it. And we should see when I click the left button, we'll see the word hello on the top left. So what we're doing is anytime our controller gets the input action button 1, it is going to call on the pawn the handle action button 1 event. Now the pawn is going to see if it has a handle action button 1 event, and if it is, it's going to do something. Let's go ahead and actually delete this, see what happens when we hit play. Nothing, but we're not getting any errors, that's the key. It will attempt to call it on the pawn, and the pawn will say, okay, it's there, or okay, it's not. But it will not give you a failure state, and will not give you an error, and you're not going to need to cast. So it's really handy when you don't want to really hard link things together. So now that we have this actually working, let's set up our line trace. Our line trace is pretty simple. We type in line trace and we get two options, by channel and by objects. We're going to go by channel because our channel is going to be visibility. Let's hook this up and look at the options. We're basically going to need to fill in a start point and an end point. And honestly, that's it. Everything else is optional. So let's find out where our start and our endpoint is going to be. Well, our start should be pretty simple. Our start is going to be where we are, where we're looking from. It's going to be our camera. And our endpoint is going to be somewhere in front of us, a certain distance. So if we were to get the camera, for example, well, we're going to have an issue. We don't have a camera that we can actually get from. Why don't we have a camera that we can get from? Well, even though this controller looks like it has a camera, it's not an actual camera object. Technically, if you use the camera manager, you can get that camera. But because it's not a physical object and it's not really part of your player, you're going to have difficulties getting a start point. What we're going to want to do is actually set up a camera with the character. So that way you have an adjustable camera, you can adjust the FOV, you can adjust the height, you can adjust anything you want on the camera itself, and we'll have a good starting point for our learning trace. So let's go ahead and do that. Inside of our character, you'll notice we have, this is it. We have an arrow pointing forward, we have a mesh that we can add a static mesh to, a skeletal mesh, and then we have the capsule component, which is our collision. Well, let's go ahead and do add component, camera, and it's going to add a new camera. That's technically all we really need to do. I'm going to go ahead and rename this FP camera, because let's say we want one character later that has a first and a third person camera, and maybe we want to switch back and forth. So let's just think ahead. So we'll call it FP camera. Now, I want to go ahead and move this up a little bit. Let's put it more like head height. That way we're not looking through the chest. And if we were to run this and hit play, well, we're not really going to see much of a difference. Technically, we are up higher, but it's not really visible because we don't have a point of reference. But we are going to have one issue. You can't tell, but right now I can look left and right and I can move, but I can't look up and down. Well, the problem with that is now that we've added in our new camera, we are no longer using the default controller's setup for looking. We're using the camera setup and our character movement. Now, the problem with that is you're not going to be able to have the proper pitch because you're not using the controller anymore for movement. It's a really simple bug to fix, but it's something to keep in mind when you add your camera and you notice immediately you can no longer move. Because keep in mind in here, we're using the player controller for the pitch and the yaw. And inside of our character, well, it's not using the pitch and the yaw. If we go into here under FPS character, which is our root object for our character, under pawn, you have a few options. Use controller rotation pitch by default for whatever reason is unchecked. Now the rotation yaw is checked. Now if we were to uncheck that, and I go back in here and hit play, now the mouse does nothing. I could move, but my mouse is not moving. So to fix this bug, because we're using the player controller's rotation, we need to tell our character to use the controller rotation for both pitch and yaw. And that's it. If I go back in and hit play, now I can actually look up, down, left, right, and everything's working again. So keep that in mind. If you have your own camera in here, make sure your character's set up to use the controller's rotation and pitch if you are using the controller convenience functions. So now that we've gone ahead and we fixed that bug, we can move around again. Let's go ahead and try to figure out where we're at. Okay, we're setting up our start and end. So again, we have our camera now. We're going to go ahead and set that up as our start. Well, where is our camera at? Let's get the world location. And this is where our camera is at in the world. And we set that up as our start. Well, that's simple enough. Now we need to figure out where our end point is going to be. Well, our end is going to be in front of us. Let's say 1,000 units in front of us. So we need to get where we're at now for our starting point, figure out what is forward, go 1,000 units forward, and use that as our ending point. This is pretty simple. If you take your camera and get the world rotation, what we're going to do is this get world location gets where we're at in the world. This one gets how we are rotated in the world. And again, we have convenience functions for forward and right, so we'll use those. Get the forward vector. And if we added that into our end point, we'd think we might be done. But the problem is, this is going to be the forward vector from where we currently are. We want the forward vector 1,000 units ahead of where we currently are. So what we need to do is let's take our forward vector and multiply it. So we'll go ahead and do a vector times a float. We'll tell it to multiply by 1,000 because that's what we wanted to aim for. And we'll put that in our end. Now, if we run this and let's set up our debug to duration and we run this, we are going to run into a bug. Now, this red line up here, this is the start point where we fired from. Let's make that longer, shall we? Let's go persistent. And let's go ahead and fire. So when we fire, the start, you know what? Let's actually make a wall. That way we actually have something that we can shoot into and we can see. So all I'm doing is adding a cube from our modes, dropping it into the scene, and then scaling it up so we can actually see. Let's go ahead and go over here and let's fire. So here's our starting point for our line trace. This is going to be where our player is. You can ignore the left one because that's when I fired left. Now down here is our contact point for our line trace. And if I was to look behind this, you'd actually see the rest of it going off to the 1,000 points. So, well, we can fix that. Now I can actually go around. Let's try this again. So looking, firing, looking behind it, you can actually see it turns green where it hits and it continues on. That's our end point for 1,000. This is our begin point for 1,000. And this is our impact point, our hit point. But one issue you'll notice is, even though we're firing forward, for whatever reason, it's not going at our cursor. It's not hitting our crosshair. There's something wrong. Well, while it may seem like we are firing forward 1,000, we're missing something here. You're not telling it where to go 1,000 from. This is telling our start point, and this is just getting a rotation that's forward. What we need to do is we need to add a vector and a vector together. These two to tell it where our end point is. We need to add our world's location and then add 1,000 units forward in order to get where our end is at. Now if we go back in and play and we fire, you'll notice we're going to hit straight ahead exactly where we want to. And there we go. That is going to be our line trace as we are firing forward. If we go ahead and run our debug, you'll notice it hits dead center at all angles. And you'll notice our hit point is being identified properly by this little square. That is going to wrap up this video. In the next one, we're going to cover actually handling when we hit something with our line trace and doing something with it.